everybody. You're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. Today is going to be a little different. We're using PsycOpG2 once again, but we're looking at SQL injection. Thank you to the recent subscribers and viewers lately. I greatly appreciate it. Now, I'm not some kind of cybersecurity person, nor am I some dedicated database administrator. But anyone who's new to computer science or doing data analytics may not be informed on this. So let's do a few things. This is mentioning possible topic for the next video. You need to import pandas, PsycOpG2, and if you have your user credentials, throw those in here. If you do not have those or need those, feel free to use this setup right here. Okay, feel free to go on my GitHub and download this code. There'll be a link in the description below. And if you download, you'll have this link provided, which will help you get the config files. And there will be a card above if you want to watch that video. Now, I make my connection by calling in my key value pairs that were stored in my config file, and I call in this cursor that I'm creating, allowing me to run my queries in read and write files. I can do autocommit equals true, for instance, if I'm interested in having all of my data transferred now. You have a few issues with string representation. For instance, SQL will use the string literal, and you need to use a delimiter for this for escaping your strings. Python doesn't care if I use single quotes, double quotes, whatever. Doesn't matter. If we were using some form of online website, this is where SQL injection can be an issue. Let's look at a few examples that I made up. We could have some website for some nonprofit that accepts donations, all right? And these donations could be denoted by current campaigns. So if I was on the website and I clicked a button that said See Donations page, then I get this little link for current campaigns that I can click on, and that's what would open up. And the query behind the scenes for this website may look something like this, where you're using a select statement and we're looking for any of the current campaigns. You could have this current equals one representing what you should see or what you should not see. If it was zero, for instance, you know, like if it was available campaign or if it's a future campaign. Now, anything you're going to see in red is something that's a no-no. You don't want to do. But in order to figure out what types of test cases you need to account for instance, sometimes you need to break something to make it work better. So if you notice this double dash, I guess, that inside of SQL Postgres represents a comment. So as soon as you throw this in, you have something interesting occur. And it seems very innocuous, but it can have some horrible side effects. For instance, as soon as we throw this in here, you're basically negating this. All right, so it's going to look for all current campaigns, but then anything that happens after it is going to be considered a comment. And so that's kind of an issue, right? And you notice this little single quotation, right? And we're basically referencing the current campaign available, but we're ignoring everything else, which is allowing the data to become visible. If this was a malformed website that didn't take care of this type of thing. And now you got to worry about our pirates who can have a little party. Well, we're going to be a pirate today. Let's do this right. We throw this in to the website like this, and this is what it would look like as an interpretation of your query, doing a select. But we say to ourselves, well, why not go further? Let's try to get some more information. We stop. We're pirates. We take what we want. So let's run down here and say, what about if we do something a little bit different? What if we have something evaluate to true? So we're using an OR operator and we're concatenating onto our string now. And if we said, let's say 1 equals 1, and let's cancel out anything that happens after the fact, so this always evaluates to true. And now you have something where you should say, oops, because now you're allowing all your data to be free for viewing. And that's very problematic. And you could say to yourself, how should we start dealing with this? Well, let's look at a few further examples and see what's going on here. So to scroll down, and please, please don't forget this, okay? Don't do this type of thing in practice. We have two things you have to understand not to use: string parameter interpolation and concatenation. So we're doing some kind of SQL statement, and we're inserting some data into some database for some user information, and we're throwing in some name value, and you see this single quotation mark, and then we have this right here, this percent %s, and this is just a parameter that's allowing us to like be a placeholder, and that placeholder is going to allow us to put something in after the fact, which would be a string. Now let's say that we're going to input some data into this query using our PSYCOPG2, and we run our execute, and we throw in this query. We use this string parameter interpolation and throw in whatever information that's going to come for our input data. And this is where you could start inputting something that's very harmful. So we throw this in, and what happens? Well, what if we decided to do an update? And you could just say, well, what happens if I wanted to change somebody's admin privileges to be true? Well, that's quite a big problem, because now if you do that and you access their database, you could start dumping all the database. You could delete everything. You could restrict privileges on other people. There's a lot of problems that can happen with this, okay? So this little old simple thing that seems insignificant can be a real big issue. That single quotation is something you want to avoid. It's not good. It's going to mess up everything, because its underlying structure is going to be interpreted as a query, okay? So anything that you put inside of this is going to be read in just like any other query. That's why we could throw in an update, we could insert, we could do whatever the heck we want to do, and that's why this is a no-no, all right? This portion right here is also a no-no that you don't want to do either, because what's going to happen to you is soon you're going to be getting fired. But there's things in the real world that could help us adjust to this and understand that we're doing something wrong or try to catch it. Well, the good thing about PSYCOPG2 is we have the ability to interpret and automatically convert a Python object to and from an SQL literal. Well, what the heck does that mean anyway? For instance, we don't have to pass something in like this, but instead we use our placeholder friend just like this without our single quotations, and that means we're going in the right direction now. But we're not out of the woods yet. Let's look at our good old friend string concatenation and see that while this may look like it's legit when we're just dealing with Python, when you start dealing with databases, this can be a big old nope. And something else you need to be aware of, that where clause is where you can start having people inject data into as well. And this is only one form of SQL injection that can be a problem. There's many more, okay? Where you can start manipulating the where clause, where you can start storing data directly from the website, which would be called a second order SQL injection, whereas this is called the first order, I think. Don't quote me on it. Google it, and I left some links for you to search this further. Now, how can we deal with this kind of stuff? You want to always think about using parameterized queries. Well, what is that? Let's get into a couple examples and see. So just start thinking about any time that you use an input statement. Always have alarm bells in your head, and there's going to be some vulnerability, and you need to check and validate. Always think input statement, possible bad things could occur. How can we take care of this? Use checks and validation to help curb this problem. But understand, this will not always solve 100% of your problems, okay? So assuming today we're dealing with a car dealership where we have some kind of website and some API where we're pulling data. Similar to what we had in the last video, let's say. And we have some pirate, and let's call him Brown Eye Jerry. Something like somebody I knew in grad school who was a real one of these. And let's assume that he wants to enter our website from the back door, as all pirates do, and exploit my website. Well, Mr. Brown Eye Jerry, let's see how we could take care of him, because he's not too friendly. And we have this login page. But we're not sure how to format this page because it's not secure, since I'm a newbie and I'm naive. Let's create this good old little table right here, and let's just make it extremely simple where we're saying yes or no, they're an admin, and we just give them some name that they want to log into for their account. And we send that off, and we do this insert statement, and then we make sure that it verifies it went through, and we have our user, Mr. Alf, where I'm pretty sure none of you are old enough to remember that. And Mr. Alf, he has admin privileges, but nobody else does, because Mr. Alf is special. He's been there a long time. But now we say, all right, let's get into our pirate party mode and have a good old time. So let's pretend that this next function that you have isn't very secure, and it's going to let our little trolls, our internet trolls, and then our nefarious pirates run amok. So let's see what's going on. So let's scroll down just a little bit, and let's notice this is a bad example. I took this from this website here, but it's going to illustrate our purpose. If you are going into your database and you're selecting from this database, this particular column, and we're using our big old no-no that I said above, and another big old no-no that I said above, and we're going to fetch just one of these. And assuming that they go onto the website and they type in whatever they have, and this function's behind the scenes evaluating if indeed this person is an admin, all right? Now let's look at this. Mr. Alf, it says he's an admin, and Mr. Yeye, or Ms. Yeye, or somebody named Yeye, evaluates the false. Now this right here, I cut it and pasted it into the next one, because this is where the pirate starts doing his exploit. And it says, well, Mr. Pirate, yes, indeed, he is an admin. Well, hold on, what is this junk that you input in here? Well, since you had that string right up here, I can input any kind of thing I want. And since I have this ending the query and you put this single quotation, now I'm going to start inputting this as reading it as a regular old SQL query, and you're selecting it to be true. So you're just basically forcing it to be true, and anything after this is going to be read in as a comment. So what if I had a password and I'm just overriding anything and I just have some made up username, or I found out what someone's username was and I chuck this in, I could avoid using a password, for instance. So say, oh man, this sucks. And how is this getting read in verbatim? You're saying select from this column DB admin from our table website user staging, where some user is going to be equal to whatever. But it doesn't matter what this evaluates to, because you're chucking in select true and negating everything else. But what really happens here? You always have a select which is going to be true, and you throw in this comment, and like I said, you could ignore a password if it was there. And this could be very bad, because if you chucked in instead something else for your statement, like an update or, you know, changing privileges or dumping a database, that's where this is going to be very, very bad. So updating this function, instead, you can use this type of formatting, which is useful. And the thing here is that you're basically using like a key value pair, where you're forcing yourself to use a parameter saying this username is this. I'm chucking in some username and it's going to go here. Is it going to work? Yes or no? If we have some issue, you got an exception that'll be thrown. Okay, sounds good. This will take care of our little pirate trying to circumvent this website, okay? But there's a few things that we need to note. One, we created a name parameter which is linked to the username, okay? And two, we're not using our nasty single quotes. That's what I'm saying here, is we're linking this to this, which is great. Now I want to show you a couple things that you do not want to do. You don't want to do string concatenation. You don't want to use that stupid single quote or that interpolation. You don't want to do a regular string formatting like you would do in regular old Python. And using this is just the same as using basically this, you know, just letting you input whatever the heck you want with this F string. You don't want to do that. You can use this placeholder, which is native to the PSYCOPG2, or you can use this formatting, all right? And you're still forcing no matter what that username. Now, let's see what this looks like if you're using PSYCOPG2. There's two things you need to understand, literals and identifiers. Identifiers deal with tables and columns. Literals are your string, numeric, and date literals. You want to use this from PSYCOPG2 import SQL. That's going to help you, you know, somewhat safely write your queries. All right, you should always run back and look for, see if you could, you know, do anything nefarious or malicious and make sure it works right. So you have this function here, why I'm making sure I have a string for our table name we're going to look for, this column, as well as the result from that column, which will be some particular row that we're going to query on. So I'm trying to find some data from a table with some specific column having a specific value. That's what's going on with this function. I'm calling in whatever I do for my query, and I decided to use a formatting. There's a lot of different stuff here. I highly suggest you go on to the documentation here to figure out what else. And I left another link. Now, we're using this identifier so we can call in our table that we're going to input, as well as our column. We're using the literal because this is a value as a string from one of the rows that I want. I throw this into the cursor.execute that we always use for running our queries, and I'm going to fetch anything to see what pops out here. I'm calling in my function, the database we're working with, or excuse me, the what table we're working with, what column we're looking for, and what row information we want to narrow down. And then I threw this into a data frame. so we could print this off. So we're looking for anybody with the first name of Anthony. And here's the head of that, the first few entries. There's like 20, I think, something like that. We could set this up a little bit differently. All right, instead of having that function, we can run this whole thing, and I'm going to use my string parameter, which is my little placeholder, and still use that formatting. But this is a little bit different, where I'm only calling in my table, and I'm calling in my column, and I'm putting those here as my identifiers. And then when I execute this, I want to call in Anthony from the query that we're calling. Don't forget this comma. And I threw this into a data frame as well, and you can see what this looks like now. And it outputs the same thing, just depending on what kind of formatting you want. But the gist of this was to allow you to see, hey, here's some vulnerabilities we have. If indeed you in the future decide to create a website, like I'm interested in, or if you're doing some kind of work where you have to be particular, you know, dealing remotely, these are some of the things that you want to look into and maybe consider. And it might even come up for a job interview. You never know. But these are tools that, you know, I think are useful and something you should look into. There's other notable SQL injections, and I would suggest going to this website and evaluating those, and also look at our good old friend, Mr. Google. But please like, share, and subscribe. And if you subscribe, turn on that notification bell. As always, I'll see you in the next video. Bye.